Praise the Lord. Who's ready for the Word of God today? Amen. Let's give all of our young people a big hand. Thank you for being in our Sunday morning worship set together, because you're going to hear a great testimony coming up here at the end of the message. Today's message is part three of our series called Faith Is. Been getting a lot of great feedback from all of you. Thank you so much. And I'm so excited about what God is doing, speaking to us about faith sharing with us about our heart, that I believe inside of our heart, there's new levels of faith being released today. Everybody say today.
Today.
You know, when I started this series, the Lord said, you're building a foundation, a biblical foundation, for us to take everybody to a new level of faith. And this morning when I woke up, I heard the Lord say, you're going to receive new dreams today. New dreams are being released into our hearts today, and some of you have been carrying dreams. He's releasing new faith to see the dreams realized. It's time. Everybody say, it's time. It's time. It's time. It's time. Let's give him praise together. Now's the time. Amen. Well, part three is titled, Jesus, the Author and Finisher of Our Faith. He's the author and finisher. I'm going to talk about this concept today. What does it mean that he is the author and finisher? And I really believe it's going to help us tie into the concept of faith towards God. Because as the author, he's the one who starts our faith. As the finisher, he's the one who sees us through to the very end. Aren't you glad you have a Savior that's going to see you through to the very end? Amen? So let's look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 together. And it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Read it out loud with me. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. You know, let's think about it. Isn't it interesting how whenever we began this journey called faith, we enter in at different times of life. Sometimes we enter into faith as a child or as a young person. Others, how many of you entered into your journey of faith after you were 18? Raise your hand. It started after you're 18. All right. See, about, you know, a good 35, 40%. You said, hey, I started this journey after becoming adult. And the thing that is so exciting, when you began your journey of faith, think about this. Did you just wake up one day and say, I want to walk with God? Somehow, I felt this need to look for God. There was like something missing inside of me. When I began my journey with God, there was this inner revelation. Something is missing. Something is lacking. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Up to then, I thought I was great. Everything seemed fine. But all of a sudden, I had this inner need to connect with God. And I believe that's what the Bible speaks about, his calling. How many of you know whenever you get your phone buzzes, rings, does whatever it does to let you know somebody's on the other end, you respond to that call, don't you? And that's the calling of God. So he even initiates that calling. See, beginning faith, our life of faith did not originate from us, and it cannot be completed by us. It's an amazing opportunity where each of us are invited into God's narrative. Once we accept, we enter into the realm of the author's faith. There's an author for your life. There's an author for my life. He's writing stories. He's writing narratives. And he wants us to be the key character. Each and every one of us are invited at different times. It's like now we become awakened to the author's voice. And when I become awakened to the author's voice, his grace comes into my life and something begins and something changes. And he gives me a dream that's bigger than me. See, receive a dream that's bigger than you. Each and every day, each and every step, we are given hopes, dreams, thoughts or ideas, which are amazing and wonderful. They can also seem so unattainable by our own abilities. How many of you have ever had something compel you on the inside, but there's a part of you that says, why am I thinking this is possible? This is so big, this is so crazy, but yet I think it could actually happen. Raise your hand if you've ever had this type of crazy thought in your life. Now, I know all of us have what we call the drive-by-the-lottery sign hope. In that flashing moment, you see $51 million, and you're like, well, I'd hope to win that. But of course, you'd have to buy a ticket, and most of us don't, and that's okay. But I'm talking about something on the inside that's so big and so crazy, but yet you believe it could actually happen. I'm talking about God-sized dreams. I want to visit today about an author, one who is writing a story, and he invites you to be part of a story. And as you say yes to this call, as you move closer to him, he begins to fill your heart with something big, something amazing, something compelling. And you start a journey with the author of your faith. And you know what? As we get these dreams, we have to receive finishing faith. Through the faith he supplies each and every day, we cooperate with him. We know that only he can finish the narrative which he has written about our lives. Only he can give us that faith which is necessary to see these dreams achieved. This is our finishing faith. Wow. And no matter what the story is, no matter what the narrative is, there is an enemy that will come and try to get us to stop somewhere before we finish the book. And as the enemy comes and he wants to discourage you, to change your view, to look at a different author, to look at a different story, to believe a less than story for your life, he's constantly trying to get us to quit the book the author is writing. But if we keep our eyes on him, he'll give you the faith to let the book finish out. Isn't that an amazing thought? That if we will stay in the faith, and today I'm going to talk about how to stay in finishing faith, that we will be able to see his story for our life finish the way he wants. It starts with the calling and the invitation of God. You see, he calls us, he invites us to experience a life with him that allows him to do something in us that is better than we could ever imagine. I know that when I started this journey with Christ and I was 19 years old, my aspirations were to get a job. What are you going to do with your life? I'm going to get a job. Now, that's not all bad, but that was my aspiration. Another aspiration I had, I was going to go to school. I was going to go to college. I was going to get my degree. My older brother, Dan, he had received his degree, and I was going to follow, and I was going to get a degree. Somehow, my brother had painted a picture for me that said, it's good to go to college. It's good to graduate and have your degree. So I had this dream, I would have a job, I would have a degree. That was the limit of my dream until I met Jesus. And suddenly, I started seeing the world in a different light. I began to believe things were possible that were coming into my heart from heaven. See, we cannot finish what God has begun. Only he can finish this for us. Only he can finish it in us, and only he can finish it through us. Everybody say, I need finishing faith. And see, I don't believe enough people have preached on finishing faith. Matter of fact, I've never heard anybody preach on finishing faith. There was a man by the name of Kelly Varner who came and spoke a word over me back in about 2007. And Dr. Varner said, Greg, you need finishing faith for the vision God has given you. He said, your faith won't be enough to finish what God has given you, but God has the faith you need. And I'll never forget those words by Dr. Varner. He says that your faith cannot finish the story God is writing about you, but he will give you the faith you need. How many of you know that's true for each and every one of us? Amen. Let's give him praise. Now, God wants us to activate our faith. Look at Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. We're going to read this out loud. And as we read it, some of you are going to be like, I've heard that before. All right, let's read it out loud. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For by grace you have been saved. Through faith. Our faith is our response to the call of grace that comes into our life. Grace is God's power. Grace is God's ability. Grace is that love. It is that hope. It's that inner belief that something is coming from heaven that I want to experience. Grace says, whatever God sends your way, He will help you to achieve it. And He sent salvation my way, and I said yes. How about you? But I didn't say yes because I was such a good guy. I said yes because God was such a great God. You know what I mean? He's such a good God. Somehow I said yes. So by grace, I've been saved through faith. Where did that faith come from? It came from God. He gave me the faith so that I could believe in His grace. He's a good God. How many of you are starting to see a pattern forming right now? See, because for us to move into finishing faith, we have to understand how the front end really begins, okay? So all this fits together. In this verse, faith works through grace. In this verse, we see that everything that comes from God to us is initiated through His grace. Grace invites us to activate faith. Grace empowers us to be interested in what God is offering to us. When we think of our faith, we must first understand it can only operate by God's grace, which is extended towards us. While you're sitting here today, you know, why are you here today? Well, my mom made me come. Other than that, you guys have heard the story. I've told it before. You got time for one little story? Maybe some of you haven't heard it. You know, and so the mom is waking up the son saying, go to church today, go to church today. He's like, I don't want to go to church today. You got to go to church today. And he says, I don't want to go to church. Said, you know what, they don't even like me at church down there, and I just don't want to go to church. And mom said, you got to go to church today. You're the pastor. All right, so, no, all right. Why are we at church today? God's called us. He's inviting us to find out more of the story. Why do you get up and pray in the morning? He's inviting you to hear more of the story. Why do you read your Bible? He's inviting us to see more of the story. Wow. I was thinking about this, and the Lord took me to a very interesting passage of Scripture. He said, think about Peter walking on the water. How many of you have heard the story of Jesus walked on the water and then Peter walked on the water? Raise your hand. You ever heard that story? We're going to read that together. And I just want us to read it real quick and think about this for a minute together. In Matthew chapter 14, we find in verse 24, meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land. Have you ever been in trouble far away from the land? Well, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land, for a strong wind had risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. Now, what in the world are they doing out at 3 o'clock in the morning on a boat? Well, Jesus had told them to go to the other side, and later on in the story, we'll find out what transpires on the other side. But before they get to the other side, a demonic storm arises. How do you know it's a demonic storm? Because Jesus rebuked it. Yes. Jesus would never rebuke the work of the Father. See, the narrative had them going to the other side, but the devil tried to stop it. But how many of you know that Jesus can walk on top of anything the devil throws at you? Come on. And so they're like, he's like, guys, get in the boat and go to the other side. And at 3 o'clock in the morning, they're going, I don't think we're going to make it to the other side. But then when the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. And in their fear, they cried out, it's a ghost! But Jesus spoke to them at once. Don't be afraid. He said, take courage. I am here. There's that word, I am. And I'm tying that into our series. And one of these days, I'm going to get a whole message on that one done. But Jesus says, I am here. I am present. Don't be afraid. You know, sometimes when God brings provision, we're afraid of it because it's so supernatural. Sometimes God has an answer for our prayers. God has an answer for our great need. And it is so crazy and it is so big. It's bigger than the natural way of things happening. We're afraid of that. But I Am shows up and says, just hang with me for a minute. Then Peter called out to him. I love this in verse 28. Peter called out, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water. Yeah. How many think I would have not have said that? It'd be like, I'm glad you're here. Let's worship Jesus. Guys, he's here. It's going to be okay. Peter's like, if that's really you, let me walk on the water too. See, whenever you have an encounter with God, you want to do what God is doing. Come on, that's a God-sized dream. There's something that God is up to that says, if that's really you, let me be up to it with you. Let me go do something that you're doing. Let me do something no one else is doing, but if you're doing it, I'll do it too. And Jesus said, Peter, come on down. Wow. That's crazy, isn't it? Come on down. And so Peter went over the side of the boat, and he started walking on the water. That's cool. How many of you know that's cool? That nobody else has done that ever since. I remember when I was a kid, I'd go to the swimming pool, and I'd try to walk on water. And I'd go running as fast as I could. Not supposed to run, but I did. And I'd say, how many steps could I go before I drown, you know? But Peter walked on water. That's awesome, isn't it? And he started walking towards Jesus. But guess what happened? But when he saw the strong winds and waves, everybody, what did he look at? His circumstances. He looked at the wind, he looked at the waves. Now this all ties into looking unto Jesus. We're going to break this down here in a minute. But when he saw the strong winds and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. But he had the presence of mind to say, save me. And, you know, people talk about how he sank, but I want to talk about how he walked. See, that's a God-sized dream. It wasn't the whole story, but it's a really cool part of the story, isn't it? In Peter's narrative, he got to walk on water. Why? Because Jesus invited him to. What is Jesus inviting you to do? And what if when you go out and do what he invites you to do? You're out there walking on the water. You're like, hey, guys, look at me. I'm walking on the water. And then all of a sudden you're like, I'm walking on the water. And he saw his eyes were fixed no longer on Jesus. They're on the wind and the waves. What happened to him? Started to sink. But aren't you glad that finishing faith was still standing on the waves? The author of finishing faith, he was still standing on the water. Somebody say, my author's standing on that water. He's standing on that wave. Oh, yeah. And so he says, save me. And Jesus pulls him up. And look what Jesus says to him. Now, that's okay, Peter. At least you tried. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him and says, you have so little faith. Why did you doubt me? And Peter's like, but none of the other guys did that. But Jesus was like, come on, man. You were doing it. Don't shrink back. Finishing faith says don't stop short once you encounter some wind and some waves. Oh, we're all going to have some wind and waves in our lifetime, friends. There's going to be something that wants to take you down, take you under. But how many of you know the author and the finisher is still standing on the waves? Wow. Come on. Praise God. I like that. Jesus was like, don't you go back being happy that you're in the boat. I called you to learn how to walk on water. Don't ever lose sight of God-sized dreams. And even while I'm speaking, some new ones are percolating in your life. While I'm speaking right now, some of you are starting to hear something brand new from heaven. While I'm speaking right now, some of you are underwater going, blub, 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 save me, Lord. Let's look at it again, how it reads in the Amplified Version of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Looking away, read this out loud with me, okay? Looking away from all that will distract to Jesus. Anything is going to distract, I have to look away from that. Here's the key. How do I move into finishing faith? How do I tap into beginning faith? How do I move into finishing faith? I have to keep my eyes on Jesus. Did the wind and the waves distract Peter? Yeah. So here we're looking at this as the Amplified says, now we'll read, let's continue. You're like, I was trying to read and you interrupted me. Now, we'll read it together. Looking away from all that will distract to Jesus, who is the leader and the source of our faith, giving the first incentive for our belief, and is also the finisher, bringing it to maturity and perfection. He, for the joy of attaining the prize that was set before him, endured the cross, despising and ignoring the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Woo! Give him praise for that one. Come on. Just give him a little bit more praise for that one. Oh, one more time. Just a little bit more praise for that one. What did he do with the shame? Look up there. What did he do about shame? He ignored it. Ooh, Jesus is our example. Oh, there'll be stuff that come in your life that might try to put shame on you, might want to put rejection on you, might want to say that you're not good enough. But you know what? He ignored all that stuff because he had his eye on a prize. There's a prize awaiting all of us who keep the faith. Tell your neighbor, I'm going to keep the faith. I'm going to keep the faith. Oh, there's a prize awaiting us. See, things will come, and they'll get us sidetracked. And you say, well, we're so-and-so. How come they don't walk with Jesus anymore? Something came along and took their eyes off of him. Sometimes it'll say bad things about God, and you'll say, wow, now I believe bad things about God. God loves you. God loves you so much. He gave his only son for you. Jesus loves you so much that he endured the suffering of the cross. He ignored the shame. He was resurrected from the grave, and he gives eternal life to all who believe. There's nothing bad about my God. Don't let somebody tell you that God is not good. Yeah. Amen? But that's what happens. How come they're not walking with Jesus anymore? Something took their eyes off of him. And the big, you know, any story that's a good story is going to have the tension of the antagonist coming into the play, into the plot, and is going to try to take your main character out. Dawn and I were watching a Hallmark movie yesterday. I'm looking at my watch. This movie's about over. I don't know if these two are ever going to know they're really in love. I didn't know if it was ever going to happen. But right in the last 8 minutes, it got wrapped up. It's amazing. Looking unto Jesus, looking. Let's break this word down, looking. Fixing our gaze solely upon Jesus, making sure someone or something else does not cause us to look away from him. That's how you get finishing faith. Don't let something come in your way. Why don't you go to church anymore? Oh, I got a new job. Man, praise God for having a job, but don't let getting a job stop cause you to stop worshiping. Amen. Well, we had a kid. Well, that kid's going to be around a while. You won't sleep for 18 years, and even at 18, I'm not promising you anything. So I'm telling you, just get up and come to church. All right, now. Offer Ahu. It means to look away from one thing so as to see another. Not only am I not going to look at waves, but I'm going to look at Jesus, and I'm just going to keep looking at him. I'm going to keep looking at His promise. I'm going to keep looking at what He can do. You see, He is the author. He is the archaeos, the founder of faith, the leader of faith. Jesus is the author of our faith. He is the writer of our story. It's primarily used as a noun denoting the founder, the author, the prince, the leader. Wow. Isn't that a great thing? And boy, it takes all the weight off of me that my faith is up to me. Have you ever tried to manufacture faith? You're like, no, I gotta believe. If I could just believe. Man, your eyes are on yourself. You know, Paul, he was talking about how people looked at him differently. In Galatians 1, 23 and 24, they were only hearing it said about him, about Paul, he who used to persecute us is now proclaiming the very faith he once reviled and which he set out to ruin and tried with all his might to destroy. And they glorify God as the author and source of what had taken place in me. Wow. Isn't that beautiful? When you stay in the book and you keep your eyes on the author, people are reading your book, they'll glorify God. People will look at your life and they'll glorify God. People look at your life and say, if God did it for them, He can do it for me. But he says to those in Galatia in verse 6 of chapter 1, I'm amazed that you're so quickly deserting Him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel. Who has cast a spell on you? Oh, you foolish Galatians. Galatians 3, verses 1 through 3. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified? This is the only thing I want to find out from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? See, and this is what happens. We get so caught up in our story that now it's like, I got to finish the book. But the guy who's writing the book, the God who wrote the book and is writing the book, is the one who finishes the book. Come on. Now, I have a special guest, and I'm watching the clock, so I'm going to just tell you a little bit about our story, and I'm going to introduce her here. But I received this testimony about 6 or 7 days ago, maybe 8 days ago, and she heard God's promise to her about graduating from college debt-free. She grabbed hold of that promise, and it took her on a journey of obedience and walking through doors of opportunities. Ultimately, she saw how God caused her to grow emotionally and spiritually through the journey that started with a promise that appealed to her. Now, I don't have time to read the whole testimony. I'm going to visit with her about the testimony. But in this testimony, it says that she was going through a difficult time as she had broken up with a boyfriend. And she felt stupid. She felt like she wasn't good enough. But suddenly, she started hearing from God. Let's welcome Molly Schultz to come on up. Let's give her a great big hand. Amen. Do we have a microphone for her there? Thank you very much. Kendall has the microphone for you. Well, Molly, I told you I was going to read your whole testimony, but I didn't get into all that. But I just wanted to make sure we had time to visit about your story because, you know, I'll just kind of break it down and we'll talk together. You went through a difficult time, and you said in your testimony to me that in that difficult time, you thought you were stupid, mm-hmm. that you didn't have any confidence. And then when the breakup happened, you just felt all these bad emotions. But suddenly, it came to you, something's about to change. Just talk a little bit about where you're at that moment, feeling bad about yourself and things like that, and then how you heard from God, and you came forward for prayer about being go to school debt-free, and you said, I'm gonna grab hold of that promise. Yep. Talk a little bit about that, and how that journey unfolded.
Sure. So the breakup was like the cherry on top of my, I guess, downward self-worth. Like, I really didn't have any self-worth, and then I was like, well, if I can't get a husband, I don't know what I'm here for, you know? So at that point, I was like, there has to be more in life than just trying to find my husband, and then also then becoming a mom and moving into that type of world. I'm like, well, if I'm not going down that path at this point, there has to be another path. And psychology has always been a passion of mine. I wanted to help people with mental illness. So in order to do that, you have to go through and get your doctorate.
Yes.
And at that point, being stupid, you're like, no way, there's no chance. So I prayed. I was like, okay, well, if this is what I'm supposed to do, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to do it debt-free. So my parents are like, yeah, we'll pay for your associate's degree. After that, you're on your own. So school's expensive. And I was like, well, I don't have any money, so we'll start this process and see what happens. And we went to Omaha. I end up meeting this girl who's like, oh, my God, I love your Coach bag. It's so beautiful. I'm like, okay, God, I feel like you're telling me to give it to her. And I was like, this is my favorite Coach bag. I don't want to give it to her. So I end up emptying all my stuff into a grocery bag, and I gave it to her.
How about that?
Yep.
But you were really in faith. It was like the story's unfolding inside of you that you believe that somehow this was connected to God's provision for education.
Yeah, he told me, if you give it to her, I'll get your education paid for.
Wow. How about that? There's a hearing from God. Let's thank the Lord for that.
Yep.
So then I was talking about going to school debt-free,
yes.
And you said you came up for prayer.
I did, yeah. You were like, okay, so the school season's about to start, and I want people who are going to college to be able to graduate debt-free. And I'm like, well, that's where I'm at. So I came up, and I was like, this is what I need. I need you to pay for my bachelor's degree, and then also I need to get my master's paid for. And typically a PhD is very expensive, but you can get scholarships or you can work at the school and get it paid for. So I wasn't too worried about that, but I told him my bachelor's and my master's needs to be paid for. And within 3 months, I got hired at USAA, and they pay for all your education.
How about that?
Yep. It
was huge. So how long did it take you to get your bachelor's?
After my associate's was done, it was a year and a half, and then my bachelor's took another year and a half, so I got it within 3 years.
Within 3 years, and in the beginning of the journey, let's just thank the Lord for 3 years to wrap up her bachelor's. But the beginning of the journey, the enemy, the waves, all that stuff was,
yep,
like, I'm stupid. I'm not saying that you wrote,
yeah,
that in there.
No, I did think I was stupid.
See,
I didn't think I was good enough to even get through community college. And then once I did, I was like, well, that was easy. What's next?
Mm-hmm.
So.
And you were on the president's list and everything,
yes,
else. And you found out that you were very intelligent and very bright. Amen.
Yep. Graduated. Yep. I graduated with on the honors list in community college, and also I got onto the honors list in Grand Canyon University.
Amen. GCU alum, put her there, yeah. Now, but then the story gets even better.
Yes.
Because, I just have to say this real quick, and I know time is getting close, but you went to a counselor, and they said the only way for you to get scholarships was to do what?
Either become a single mom or be in the poverty level.
That was the counselor at that school's advice to her, was to go get pregnant,
yep,
and be a single mom.
Yep.
How many of you know God has a different story? Amen?
Yep.
Now if you are a single mom, God has a story for you, but that was the advice that was given. You said, no,
that wasn't my path.
No.
That wasn't what I was supposed to be doing at that point in,
yeah,
time. And I didn't want to go put myself in a situation where I was gonna struggle financially if I was supposed to be living debt-free.
And you had that debt-free promise inside of you. See, that's great.
Yep.
You went on, and then you got your master's. Tell a,
yeah,
quick story about master's. And Dylan, I want you to work your way up here right now, buddy. Come on up. But talk to us about the...
I already told you you should come with me.
Come on up. Big hand for Dylan. He's coming up. I married these two. When was the wedding? About 3 years ago?
It was over 2 years ago.
Well, yeah, it,
yeah,
was it a fall wedding?
November 7th.
Yeah. And so, Dylan, come on over here, buddy. Now, you weren't the beginning of this story. This is a new guy who God brought into the story. But tell us about the master's and the rest of the story.
Yeah, so I'm about to graduate with my bachelor's degree, and then I look at the master's degree, and master's degrees are also very expensive. So I'm thinking, yeah, I don't have 20, 30 grand out of my pocket to pay for this, and USAA only pays for a certain amount of schooling. So I was like, okay, well, Lord, we're in the same situation as we were a year and a half ago. What's going to happen? And my counselor at the time, he was a different counselor, he was like, well, GCU pays for, Grand Canyon University pays for school 100%. And I was like, wait, so all of my master's will be free? And he's like, yeah, and Dylan's school will also be covered.
Come on, baby.
So at the time, Dylan was about halfway done with his bachelor's degree. He just needed about a year and a half left, and I had the full master's about a year and a half left as well. And I got hired immediately. I had an interview, and then within an hour and a half, they called me and asked me if I would work for them.
Isn't that great?
Yeah.
What an amazing story.
Yeah, so Dylan and I both are graduating in April now, debt-free.
So proud of you guys.
You know, it's such a great story, and I wanted everybody to celebrate with you, and I wanted to inspire us. And you know, whatever it is that God puts in your heart, allow Him to do it. You know, you had to go to work.
Yeah, I had to train that whole time.
Because I've had people say, you know, whenever I pray over, you know, you're going to go to college debt-free and checks in the mail and stuff like that. And I've had people come up to me and say, you know, I don't think you should do that because that's just wrong. And it gives people false hope and this, that, and the other. And friends, whenever God calls you to something, He'll always challenge you and He'll take you through a journey that's going to cause you to grow. What has happened in your life since that breakup and thinking you were so stupid to now? How do you feel about yourself?
I'm a totally new person. I'm not that person anymore.
Isn't that great? Well, let's all stand together. And I want you guys to stay up here with me. I'm just so proud of the two of you. It's a real honor to do your wedding. It was 2 years ago?
Yeah, two years ago.
And time goes by so fast, but something was just so sweet there at that wedding. I just saw something special. And Dylan, God has healed you physically, and I know about the supernatural healing that's taken place in your life right here at the church, and that's another story for another day. Mm-hmm. But we're just so thankful for the two of you. And I want to invite anybody that's out there right now to say, I have a dream that God is writing in my life, and I believe my God is going to finish that dream. Come on up. Come on up. Just stand up here. Stand up here with Molly and Dylan. God is in the book writing business. He's the great author. He's the great finisher. Come on up today. And maybe for some of you young people out there, you're like, you know, I want to go to school debt-free. Come on up. Step up. She stepped up. We need to step up. Step out of your boat. You're like, well, if I get out of this boat, there might be water on the other side. There probably is. It's not easy, is it? You had to take all those classes, write all those essays while you were working. Full-time, working full-time. See, sometimes you're like, well, I just wanted that check in the mail. I don't want to work full-time. But I'm telling you what, when you work, by the time you graduate with that degree, with that master's, whatever it is that you're working towards, that work experience along with your degree is going to move you higher up on that chart when they're looking at resumes, because you also have experience. And I'm so proud of you for that. I want us to close today, and I want to pray for people. Just close your eyes wherever you're at. Just think about this. Jesus is writing a story about you. He wants you to stay fixed on Him. Your eyes fixed on Him. It starts by saying yes to Jesus. Oh, if you've never done it before, say it right now. Yes, Jesus. you've never done it before, say it with me right now. Jesus, save me. Jesus, forgive me. If you've never done it before, start your journey right now and cry out, Jesus, be my Lord and Savior. If you've been on that journey and you're here today, say this out loud with me. Thank you, Jesus. You called me into this boat. And whenever you want me to get out, I'll get out. I'll walk where you want me to walk. I'll go where you want me to go. Because you're writing my story. And you're going to finish my story. No one else gets to tell me when my story's over. You are the author. You are the finisher. And it's going to be a good book. And it's going to be a great story. Thank you, Jesus, for being my Lord and my Savior, the author of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give him praise together. Amen. I want you to go out and let people congratulate you. I'll go ahead and take that. Thank you, everybody. Give Molly and Dylan a hug and let them know how their story blessed you today. What is that? Sign up for Women of Destiny and AIU on your way out.